Today, let's start with an overview of what's happening at Boca Chica, because it has become really silent since Starship SN8's test flight. When can we expect the next test flight? We need those test flights for our mental well-being. Then the US Space Force personnel finally received an official naming, and it's again very meme-friendly. In other news, the current administration really tries to sign off with the loudest possible bang for space exploration by signing Space Policy Directive 6 on space nuclear power and propulsion.
So what implications might this directive have? Then some funny news on the Orion spacecraft, and some stuff that really makes us angry. NASA officially awarded a launch services contract to Blue Origin for a totally non-existent rocket. Hey, who said lobbying was ineffective? And lastly, some really fascinating stuff, a very interesting radio signal that might have come from the nearest star system, Proxima Centauri. A lot to talk about, so stay tuned.
So since the epic Starship SN8 test flight on December 10th, it has become really silent at Boca Chica. We remember that initially, it was planned that SN9 would immediately take over the test flight campaign from SN8. But since then, not much has happened, at least superficially. Why? Well, almost immediately after the SN8 test flight, SN9 was apparently so eager to fly itself that it wouldn't wait and tilted in the high bay, suffering some damage as you can see here, a broken forward flap. This damage is currently being repaired, as you can see on these latest recordings from NASAspaceflight.com. As always, we put the link to their awesome channel into the video description, and please go and support their channel, because their work is really invaluable to us space nerds.
Anyway, so we can see that SN9 is mounted to a crane and standing upright again. It appears that SN9 has received a new aerodynamic flap, probably the one from the SN10 nose cone. It makes sense to accelerate the repairing process of SN9 so that the testing campaign can resume ASAP. SN10's nose cone, meanwhile, has been stacked so that SN10 is also nearing the phase where it is being fully stacked to its total height. Apart from Starship, we can finally see some progress on the Super Heavy booster. The Super Heavy booster prototypes are being called BNX, so BN1, BN2 and so on, analogous to SN1, SN2, etc. Here we can already see a Super Heavy forward pipe dome for the BN1 booster prototype. More such sections arrived near the high bay, and they will be neatly placed here waiting for the stacking to commence, possibly once the SN9 has left the high bay for the launch pad.
Which should happen any day now, because the crane with the nickname Tankzilla has just yesterday been rolled to the Starship launch pad, as we can see on these impressive recordings here. So any day now, SN9 should also be rolled to the launch pad, where Tankzilla will then lift it onto the pad and where SN9 will then start the usual testing campaign. So cryo-proof tests, then static fires, and should no error or unforeseen problems occur, we might see the SN9 test flight by mid-January. Should we encounter problems though, this might be delayed until late January to mid-February.
So in the new year, we can be looking forward not only to the continuation of the test flights with SN9, but also to the first Super Heavy booster BN1 being stacked, and possibly soon after also starting a testing campaign. We are of course all eager to see if the booster prototypes will perform similarly well as the latest Starship prototypes, or if we'll see some booster prototypes fail in the cryo-proof tests. We personally think that they will perform really well, since they are already based on the latest steel and welding techniques, and the lessons learned from the Starship prototype failings have already been implemented. And if all goes well, we assume we'll witness the first orbital test flight of a Super Heavy booster plus Starship by the end of 2021 or early 2022. Amazing times are ahead. And please subscribe to our channel, as we don't shy away from discussing space politics and brutally bashing lobbying companies such as Blue Origin, Lockheed, Boeing and others. But we really need your support to make an impact, so thank you very much in advance for your support.
In other news, the US Space Force really tries their best to create as many memes as possible. We believe that the Space Force itself is really a necessary development in the wake of China and Russia's aggressive behavior in space, with anti-satellite missile tests conducted on a regular basis. But the symbolism of the US Space Force is maybe a bit too over the top. First, the Space Force insignia, which looks like the Starfleet symbol from Star Trek. Then the motto, Semper Supra. And now the revelation that Space Force personnel shall henceforward be referred to as Guardians. The same way Air Force personnel are referred to as Airmen, Space Force personnel will be called Guardians. Guardians of the Galaxy memes are of course already around, as you can imagine. We personally wouldn't make fun of the Space Force if they had some real spaceships, which they don't. So it's like the US Navy without ships, or the US Air Force without airplanes. Not really inspiring, one might say. That's the sharp contrast of the symbolism with the sad reality is what probably creates those memes. We think that if the Space Force commanded 200 Starship troop transporters to be deployed within 30 minutes anywhere on the globe, the memes would certainly be a lot less. Anyways, so since the Space Force doesn't have any vessels to speak of, in another quite funny PR move, they just converted someone in space to be the first Guardian. Colonel Mike Hopkins, who has been on board the ISS for a bit over a month now since arriving there with SpaceX's Crew Dragon spacecraft on November 17th, has now officially transferred from the Air Force to the Space Force. He has served in the Air Force for 27 years and is now officially the first Guardian of the Space Force.
The first Guardian. It sounds kind of like a cool name for an epic sci-fi movie.
Witness the amazing story of Mike Hopkins, based on true events, who flew to the ISS as a regular airman. But when danger struck and an unidentified alien vessel tried to take over the ISS, this hero became the first Space Force Guardian, successfully repelling the attack of the invading force and restoring peace and order on the International Space Station.
Anyways, despite the memes and everything, we still think this is a very important development. And we think that Space Force should be the first large customer of SpaceX, ordering lots of Starships as Guardian troop transporters so that Guardians can be deployed fast anywhere on Earth and in the future also on the moon colonies.
In other interesting development, President Trump issued Space Policy Directive 6 on Wednesday, December 16th, which lays out a national strategy for the responsible and effective use of space nuclear power and propulsion systems. And this is really good, since we all know that chemical propulsion is not the most effective way for interplanetary travel. Nuclear thermal propulsion could get us to Mars a lot faster, cutting down travel time from 6 to 3 months. So we really hope that this new directive will foster a revival of nuclear thermal propulsion and that we can see interplanetary cyclers with nuclear thermal propulsion sooner as a consequence of the directive. But of course, only time will tell if the new directive will have a big impact.
Anyways, what do you do when the Orion spacecraft faces some serious bugs due to Lockheed, the manufacturer, messing things up? Of course, you just fly with bugs. Worked pretty nicely for the Starliner, right? One of 8 power and data units, so-called PDUs, on the Orion spacecraft, which provide communications between the spacecraft's computers and other components, is not working. But why not just replace the faulty unit then? Because there is some serious engineering genius at work in this 15-year-old capsule, which has only flown to space once on an unmanned test flight. Lockheed Martin warned it could take up to a year to replace the PDU because it is located in an adapter between the crew module and service module that is inaccessible now that the two modules are mated to each other. So since this would then delay the Artemis 1 mission, on which this Orion capsule is scheduled to launch in November 2021, NASA decided, okay, you know what? If we can fix it, just leave it be. That looks okay. It should work. It looks okay. Officially, because there is supposedly enough redundancy from the other PDUs, but still, the problem solving here is quite hilarious, you have to admit.
And as if that wasn't insane enough, NASA annoys us even more by awarding a new launch service contract to Blue Origin for their new Glenn rocket. So wait, NASA tries to ignore Starship as best as they can, because it's too experimental and not tangible enough. How is that hidden for tangible? But then they award a launch contract for Blue Origin's new Glenn, which is far less tangible, because all we have ever seen of that rocket are fancy CGI animations and half a payload fairing.
We guess the lobbyists worked over hours for this one here. Come on, a bit more. Still not enough. Come on, only a bit more. Yes, that's more like it. That's nice. Okay, now we're talking. Yes. The funny thing is that the ordering period is from June 2025 until December 2027. That's right. That is already a good indication as to when we actually can expect the new Glenn. We always said to people not to expect the new Glenn before 2023 earliest, and got a lot of flaming for that, of course, but now you can see it confirmed here. We are very sure that by 2025, SpaceX's Starship will have already landed on the freaking moon and possibly even sent large payloads to Mars, for God's sake. And NASA is awarding contracts 7 years into the future for a freaking CGI product. Come on, once more, please. Come on, don't hold back. Come on. Don't be shy. Come on, one more. Now you've really earned your contract.
And now, alien time. Giorgio A. Tokalos, the alien guy, is already shooting forth, head erect, ears wide open. An alien signal from Proxima Centauri, the nearest star system, only 4.2 light years away from Earth, even though we are 100% convinced that there are at least a handful of technological civilizations in our galaxy, the probability that they are next door is not very high. The signal was picked up by the park's 210-foot radio telescope in Sheep Country, about 190 miles inland from Sydney, Australia. The signal occupies a very narrow band of the radio spectrum at 982 MHz, which is normally a region bereft of transmissions from human-made satellites and spacecraft. But this doesn't mean that it didn't come from Earth. It could indeed turn out to be a man-made signal from Earth that got picked up by accident.
Follow-up observations will be needed, and only when the signal is picked up again and really is found to emanate from the Proxima Centauri system, only then can we start to get excited. But the signal is interesting nonetheless, and we think it's only a matter of time until we detect an alien techno signature. Really, we are 100% convinced it's only a matter of time.
We would like to thank you for joining us yesterday on our last live stream for 2020. It was a lot of fun.
So this was the last space report for this year. We need a small vacation also. And we wish you Merry Christmas and a nice time with your friends and family, and also a Happy New Year. And then we see you in the new year, and we will be back with fresh energy and renewed motivation.
So thanks for watching the JI Space Report. And I would say, on to the future. And on this occasion, what should I say exactly?
So what now? You say something or?
You really found it okay.
Yes, I really found it okay.
Yeah, good. So thanks for watching the JI Space Report. And I would say,
ach so, ich hab zu früh zu dir schon geschaut.